Well, good morning, everyone. I'm Nathan Hunter. I'm the worship pastor here. I have a number of things that I want to share with you today. It's great to have you here this morning. I just want to welcome you. A number of things that I want to keep in front of you this morning. May 22nd, we'll be celebrating all the people that volunteer at Now Then Alliance Church. I'm so grateful for so many of you that serve in children and Awana and small groups and Sunday school and greeters and worship and just so many opportunities with on the board and so many different things that need to happen at this place that would not happen without you. So we are grateful for you. So we're going to have a brunch on May 22nd, and that will be at the 9:45 during the Sunday school hour. So if you come to the first service, just stay afterwards and everybody join us for brunch at the 9:45 time. And then if you come to the second service, just come early. Come at 9:45 and have some breakfast, and we'll appreciate you there. So grateful for you. Another thing, Memorial Day, we will only have one service at the 10 a.m. time. So one service at a different time for that day, 10 o'clock downstairs, and Let's Fish will be starting soon. We'll fish on Tuesday nights from May 31 through June 28, starting anytime from 4 to 7, depending on your schedule. You'll sign up for a time slot so that we don't have 20 boats there. Right now we have 20 boats signed up, and there's more coming, I'm sure. So, but we're only 2 weeks away, 2 weeks and a couple days away from that May 31 start. So need to let me know, sign up today in the back by the Let's Fish sign, or you can just put Let's Fish in your connection card and then get that to me, or put it in that black box in the back of the sanctuary or back of the gym there. Sign up today. So many different prizes. Got some prizes from Cabela's. They're helping us out with that. So I'm really super excited about that. So Josh has a few things now for you before we start in worship this morning.
Hey guys, it is finally nice outside. That means that we have garage sales going on. We have people mowing lawns right now. We have grill outs. We have lots of fun things that happen in the summer when it's nice out. And for one of those things, we have cornerball starting next week, Wednesday. The training is next week, Wednesday, and then the following Wednesday, the season starts already. A youth fundraiser we have going along with cornerball. If you're hungry, if you're coming straight from work or picking up your kids or whatever to cornerball, we're gonna be selling hot dogs, and all that money goes to the Life Conference for our youth. Speaking of youth, right after cornerball, we're doing our hangouts this summer. We're gonna be at people's houses and at the church and in people's pools. So if you're youth age, come hang out with us. Another summery thing we have going on, we have a youth fundraiser that is a garage sale coming up in the beginning of June. If you have stuff that you want to get rid of, if you have stuff that you want to buy from other people, just support our youth through that. And now we're going to go into a time of worship, so I'll kick it back to Nathan.
So many opportunities to engage this summer that's coming here, and so I want you to just to stay connected to your bulletins. You know, if you have any questions, give us a holler at the church, and because there's a lot of information there, a little bit too much maybe, but because I'm like, what all did I supposed to remember here? I don't remember. You know, that was just too much, a lot maybe. But so good to have you here. We are going to worship Jesus today. Let's all stand together as we worship Him.
Come all you weary, come all you thirsty, come to the well that never runs dry. Drink of the water, come and thirst no more. Come all you sinners, come find His mercy, come to the table, He will satisfy. Drink of His good. your blessings flow. Praise Him, praise Him for the wonders of His love. Is waiting. God so loved the world. Amen. Thank you.
Good morning and welcome to Now Then Alliance Church. If I haven't had the privilege of meeting you before, my name is Nate Kemper. I'm the lead pastor here and love that we gather each week to celebrate Jesus. And we'll continue doing that this morning in a few different ways. We'll continue to sing songs of praise to Him. Many of us will give back to God as an act of worship as well. And then we'll study God's Word together as we continue in our series in Paul's letter to the Corinthian church in 1 Corinthians. We're looking forward to all of that. And we do it all not just because it's something that we've designed or scheduled or hoped for, but because we believe as a church, we exist to equip people to find life and faith in Christ. That's part of what we do as we gather together. We believe when we're doing that well, that we connect with each other, that we grow in our own relationship with God and encourage others to do the same, and that we participate in what God is doing in our lives and in the world around us. There's a variety of opportunities for that connecting, growing, and participating. A number of them were on the video at the start of the service, and so if you're looking to connect, join us next week for brunch as we appreciate our volunteers and thank them for that. There's a free brunch available to everybody next Sunday, or sign up for the Let's Fish and join people on boats this summer and connect alongside with them that way as well. A couple of ways that people are participating, we just want to highlight some of the ways that we honor the people, the volunteers that are participating in our midst, but we've got some that are going to be looking to join God in what He's doing around the world. In about a month, we've got a team of people that's going to be going to Ecuador. We've had a partnership with them for a little over a decade now, some of the different Christian Missionary Alliance churches there. And so we've got a team of people that will be heading there to do a number of different kinds of work. They often, when they're there, helping with some of the kids ministry things that take place there, serving some of the women's ministry things, doing some construction projects and helping there. But it's also outside of the ways that they serve, it's been a ways that we've been able to encourage those churches and partner with them in their ministry. Some of the last times we went, we were able to do hospital visits, pray for people that were ill. We were able to gather people in a way that they hadn't been able to gather since COVID had started there. And so it was some of the first life being brought back into their public gatherings. And so we're hopeful to hear other ways that we can go alongside and encourage them in that. Part of what we're going to do today then is commission the team that's going to go do that. Now, some of that team was in the first service. Some of that team's currently in Iceland, so they're not here right now. And then some of that team is here with us. I'm going to have Lee and Peggy stand. Lee and Peggy are going to be leading that team. We're going to pray and commission them. If you're here and want to join me and want to extend your hearts towards them in this prayer, one of the easiest ways to do that while I pray is just to extend your arms towards them as we pray together. Would you do that with me? God, we're thankful for the spirit that you've placed in Lee and Peggy and the rest going on the trip to Ecuador. And we pray as we send them that we would send them with your spirit to be utilized for the advancement of your name and your kingdom alongside our friends and brothers and sisters in Ecuador. And so we ask for safety as they travel, as they navigate through the different travel restrictions or things that take place in this time, that they would get through all of that well, that their presence there would then be for the benefit of your glory, for the expansion of your kingdom. We pray for fruit in their own lives. We pray for Lee and Peggy particularly, that their marriage would be strengthened, that they'd be unified more with you and with each other because of this, with the team that goes alongside them. We pray for all of our team, that they would see and experience you in unique ways and be encouraged by fruit for your kingdom that shows up through the work that they do. We long to hear that report and celebrate with them how you've been at work. And so we pray it, asking it all in Jesus' name, amen. As you see Lee and Peggy or others that are on that team throughout the next month, feel free to encourage them, remind them that you're praying for them, ask them if there's specific things they have prayer requests for, and then we'll hear a report from them a little later in the summer after they get back from that trip. But they got about a month before they leave. We'll continue to talk a little bit more about that as it comes up. Well, for many of us, as we continue in worship, we do so not just through our singing or our studying, but in giving back to God some of what He's blessed us with. If you're new here or if you're visiting here, we don't want you to feel any pressure or obligation to give. Though, if you want to join us in worshiping God in that way, you can do so through the offering box that's placed in the back of the room, or anybody can give digitally at nowthenadultalliance.org. There's a give tab there that can walk you through any of the instructions for that. As we get ready to do that, we want to pray for how we would receive and how God would use these gifts. Would you also join me in that prayer? God, we're thankful for all that you've given to us, most importantly, the gift of life that you extend to us through Christ. And yet we recognize many other blessings, and so as we give some of them back to you, we pray that they would be pleasing and acceptable to you as an act of worship, that you would use these gifts to spread your love and to grow your kingdom in a world that could desperately use more of it. We pray all of this in Jesus' name. Amen.
You know, sometimes I get caught trying to fix the things that are in my life without God's help. You know, sometimes it's easy that you just cry out to God immediately in those times, and other times it surprises me that that I don't bring those things to Him. And I don't know if it's because I want to be independent, I'm proving to do that I can do the things myself, or maybe if I'm prideful. But sometimes I fail to bring my challenges in front of God. Frequently in Scripture, God wants us to believe and trust in Him for helping us through those things and not just battling it on our own. When we put our trust in Him and involve Him in our daily struggles, we're saying that He is greater, that He can lead us through. He can carry us when we're broken. He can redeem the situation and make it better. He can. His power is enough, His strength is more than enough, and His heart is good and wants to help us. He wants to lead us in that time of need. So during this song, let's do that. Let's welcome Him into those spaces in our life where we put our faith in believing that He is bigger than the mountain that is in front of us. Let's all stand together as we worship Him.
Why would I worry? Giants come calling my name. My God is so much bigger than the troubles I face. Why would I hunger for power or riches or God is so much better than all of these things. So I won't be shaken, I won't be moved. My God is faithful, His promise is true. Praise the Lord. Yes, you are Lord. We can put our trust in you. Come speak to us, Lord.
As the Spirit was moving over the water, Spirit, come move over us. Come rest on us. Come rest on us. As the Spirit was moving over the water, Spirit, come move over us. Come rest on us. Come rest on us. Calm down, Spirit, when you move, you make my heart pound. When you fill the room, you're here and I know you are moving. I'm here and I know you will fill me. Calm down, Spirit, when you move, you make my heart pound. When you fill the room, you're here and I know you are moving. I'm here and I know you will fill me. As the Spirit was moving over the water, Spirit, come move over us. Come rest on us. Come rest on us.
Spirit was moving
over the water, Spirit, come move over us. Come rest on us. Come rest on us.
Thank you.
it's a rushing wind, fire fall, burn, Holy Ghost, breathe on us, we pray. As we repent, turn from sin, revival and smoldering, breath of God, fan us into flame. As we need a fresh wind, the fragrance of heaven, pour your spirit out, pour your spirit out. Hearts that burn with holy fear, purified faith and need, refiner's fire, strengthen what we made. So we the church bear your light, lamp of flame, city by King and kingdom come, is what we pray.
God, you are bigger. You are greater. I need your spirit, Lord, in those moments when I'm facing that mountain. Give me faith, Lord, to see, to believe. You can carry us through, Lord. We don't have all the right answers, but we have one answer that's really good, and that answer is you. So we proclaim your name in this space now, right now, Jesus, that you are greater. Give us that fresh wind, that holy anointing. Amen. You may be seated.
I was 8 years old when I watched my first live-action hero movie. The movie was Rambo. My brother and I put it in while my parents were out shopping. I don't know that that's the right babysitter for an 8-year-old, but it's what worked that day. My dad got home, and I had become so excited about watching Sylvester Stallone play this live-action hero, and his powers weren't superhero powers like most of the cartoons I watched. It was his ability to use a gun, a good guy with a gun shooting all the bad guys around him, and I decided that's what I wanted to be. My dad got home, and so I said, "Dad, I want to be like Rambo. You need to teach me how to shoot a gun." I knew that's something my dad would be able to do. My dad had been serving in the Navy. He had scored expert levels on marksmanship for both handgun and air rifle to the point where the Navy had put him in charge, even though he was an officer, of teaching ambush training and tactics during his summers at Camp Pendleton. He got to play high-tech laser tag for fun because he was really good at shooting. In fact, some of the earliest video footage of me is old projector reel footage of me at 2 years old sitting on my dad's lap while he's holding me with one hand and has a pistol BB gun in the other hand shooting the grasshoppers that are hopping off the fence in the backyard. And so I said, "Dad, I want to learn to be like Rambo." And in my head, what that meant is that we would go out into the backyard and he'd grab one of his guns and he'd put up a target and I would just start shooting. But the reality of that was, instead, when it comes to people learning how to shoot a gun, there was a tangent away from being an action hero. And there were lessons that were taught long before a gun was put in my hand. Lessons about safety, about the value of life, about how you never point a gun at something you're not ready to shoot. There's a lot of different tangible things my dad stopped and taught me before we would go to the next step. And then the next step still wasn't shooting a gun. It was learning everything about the gun. How to load it, where the safety was, how to turn that on and off, how to unload it, how to check it, how to do all of those things. My dad spent time, he paused my enthusiasm over the thing I wanted to do and taught me the lessons I needed to learn first. This is true not just when my dad was teaching me how to shoot a gun at a young age, but later in life when my brother and I would get my dad gun range time as a Father's Day gift and we would go together, we would show up at the gun range and they would make us sign waivers and watch videos and go through safety checklists, all appropriate things before we were allowed to then go use the things that we had come to use. It's kind of like what Paul's doing with the church in Corinth. In chapter 12, he started talking about the spiritual gifts. And he talked about the different gifts that the Spirit puts out, and he says they're for the common good and for God's glory, for the building up of the church. And then before jumping into talking about how they should be utilized, he's going to get there in chapter 14, we'll get there next week, Paul pauses. He says, before we can jump into that, I have to teach you some things about how you'll use what you've been given. Some lessons, one particular that's important for you to know before you just get the spiritual gifts able to run rampant through you. Because I think what Paul recognizes is something we all can recognize. If we don't have those lessons, we can cause far more harm than good. We can end up in a world of a mistake. I remember when I was 20, I took a missions trip to Vietnam. There was about 18 of us that went from my college. So a large group of 18 to 20-year-olds who had flown to Vietnam. We were doing ministry there. We had a day to learn about the Vietnam War, see some of the sights, and enjoy some free time. And while we were there, we found a booth that was selling the ability to play with their guns and ammo. And so I walked up to a booth, and I handed them roughly 10 American dollars in Vietnamese currency. And in response to that, they handed me a fully loaded AK-47 and said, "Most people shoot it that way." A 20-year-old, signing no waivers, no questions about safety or concern, handed a fully loaded automatic weapon and just kind of pointed a direction to go play as I would choose. I was thankful at that moment. My dad had taught me a lot about guns. I was thankful at that moment that most of the rest of the team with me wasn't paying money to grab a gun right now, because I didn't know if they had been taught those lessons. What we can understand is there's a bunch of damage that can happen when that takes place. And Paul is aware of that. He wants the gifts of God to be used and seen and expressed throughout the church in Corinth really well. But before he starts talking about the details of that, He jumps in with a lesson about how you have to do things the right way or you're going to make bad decisions. This is how he starts. It's actually how he closed chapter 12. The end of that statement at the end of chapter 12 is Paul saying, "And yet I will show you the most excellent way." This is like the safety lesson for spiritual gifts. He's going to jump in on what we have to know before we see these things put into practice in the worship services of a community of believers. Here's how he begins. "If I speak in the tongues of men or of angels, but do not have love, I'm only a resounding gong or a clanging cymbal." What you're going to find throughout this entire chapter of Paul's writings is that the most excellent way he's going to talk about is love. That if the spiritual things that are happening in a church aren't founded on love, aren't rooted in love, it doesn't matter how biblical, how righteous, how awesome, how miraculous they look, they're useless if they're not based in love. He uses some imagery. He's going to use imagery throughout the chapter, and all of the imagery would be very poignant to the first century Corinthian church. And so here he talks about a couple of things. He talks about a resounding gong, and we often picture gongs like the Gong Show or like Asian countries that have large gongs hit with a mallet that leaves like an echoey ring through them. That is not what the Corinthian church would have pictured. It's not that those things hadn't been invented yet, but the resounding echo and clang that they often heard was vases that were made to amplify the sound of actors in the theater. An outdoor public theater or an indoor theater, and you wanted to be able to hear the person on stage, they made these vases, and Corinth had a bunch of them, where people would perform, and then the echo of the actor's voice would get louder and louder as it went out into the crowd. And then it says that they might be like clanging cymbals. This is likely what you would picture. Raucous noise happening as cymbals clang. And yet the Corinthian church wouldn't have pictured that as a drum set necessarily. They would have pictured that as the raucous worship of the pagan god Sabaoth that was in Corinth, the Greek or Roman mother god of fertility. And they would have recognized that her cult of followers worshipped in partying, loud, raucous kinds of ways. If somebody was writing it who didn't know the context of Corinth very well, you may be able to write it this way instead. "Even if you speak in the language of angels, your high-toned speech has become like the empty echo of an actor on a stage, or the noise of the frenzied pagan worship in the temples around you." Paul's saying it doesn't matter if the spiritual things all seem to be on display, even the miraculous things on display. If they're not rooted in love, they're just performance and useless. They don't have value. He continues, "If I have the gift of prophecy and can fathom all mysteries and all knowledge, and if I have a faith that can move mountains, but do not have love, I'm nothing." It doesn't matter if the words of God are being spoken through you powerfully. It doesn't matter if your faith is able to pray and see miraculous things happen. If those things are taking place, but it's not rooted in love, it's likely causing more harm than good. It's missing the point, and it's nothing. It doesn't gain you spiritual status because God chose you. You're still nothing without the love. He continues, "If I give all I possess to the poor and give over my body to hardship that I may boast, but do not have love, I gain nothing." No matter how self-sacrificial you are of your possessions, of your energy, of your service, if it's not rooted and motivated by love, it is worthless and it is nothing. We've got phrases in our own culture that get to this kind of understanding, this kind of context that have been popularized. Things like the end doesn't justify the means, or the journey matters more than the destination, or it's not if you win or lose, it's how you play the game that matters. Paul is essentially saying to the community gathered for worship in Corinth, it doesn't matter how religious you look or if the gifts are on display. That's not what's important. The most excellent way, The thing you need to figure out isn't how to have more people speaking in tongues or more people prophesying. Paul hopes that happens. But the most excellent way is to figure out how the whole community together can be rooted in love, because it's all worthless without that. We see that in other biblical examples as well. There's a way in which we can read what Paul's saying and say, okay, it doesn't matter if we do the right things if we do them with the wrong motive. You can look at examples Jesus used. He told the parable, for instance, the story of the Good Samaritan, where there's a group of people who are walking by somebody who needs help, who needs love expressed to them, and yet some of them, in their intention to obey God's law and not touch dirty or unclean things, cross sides of the road and pass by. They do the right religious thing, but it's motivated on in a task list and not motivated on loving the people near them. God says it doesn't matter what right thing you were doing according to the law. If you were doing it and it wasn't based in love, it's worth nothing. Or we can see similarly that there's people that do a lot of the right things, but they're hypocritical because they're not doing all of the things God has asked them to. In Matthew chapter 23, Jesus is confronting the Pharisees, and he praises them. He says, you do things like you tenth the tithe of even your mint and your cumin. Down to the smallest little thing, you're obeying this sacrificial generosity of giving back to God. But, Jesus says, you've neglected justice and mercy and faithfulness. You're hypocritical. You've done some of what God has asked you, but you're missing this other heart motivation that God wants you to have towards people. And so it's useless, it's worthless, it's meaningless to God. This is what Paul is saying. Paul is saying there's a most excellent way, and that way is love. It's more important than any of the religious acts. It's more importantly than the miracles or the gifts. In fact, it's the most excellent way, this love, that solves any of the division or factions within a church. It's what stops them from happening. As I was reading this week, I read a number of articles and commentaries talking about this kind of topic and these kinds of verses, and a couple of them pointed out something that was, it's counterintuitive, but it seemed true experientially to me as well. They said this: in most churches, if you pay enough attention, the most divisions come from the people who are trying to do the most spiritual things. People who have figured out what they think righteousness for the community looks like, or what we should all agree on, who have really healthy, noble, good, biblical, religious hopes, dreams, morals, and motives, are often also the people causing the most division, because it isn't motivated by love. It's motivated by doing what they think is best or right or climbing a religious status. And Paul says, in the midst of that, you can be doing all of those right things, but it's more harm than good. It's worth nothing if it isn't coming out of love. And yet this love is available to all of us, to every church. It's the life of Christ. It's what he modeled. It's what the Spirit empowers us and inspires us to do. It's granted to us because of the gospel of Jesus, and something that we can live out. And Paul is tasking the Corinthian church before he jumps into what the charismatic spiritual gifts can look like in their midst, before he talks about the tongues and the prophecy and the healings. He says, we have to get the love thing right, or it'll just cause more harm than good. And so he's going to move into an explanation of love, an explanation that may be familiar to a number of you, and yet when you hear the verses, what you're likely to picture is a bride and a groom at an altar, getting ready to take their vows and having these words of Paul read about what love looks like in their life. I want to be as clear as I possibly can. The Corinthian church did not picture a wedding when they read these verses. They didn't picture flowery, uplifting, encouraging language at all. When the church in Corinth got this letter from Paul and read these words, they would have been convicted and challenged at how far they were from meeting the mark God had for them. And we'll see that. Now, Paul, as he's getting ready to explain what this love looks like, this most excellent way, he starts with a couple of really positive attributes. Love is patient. Love is kind. kind of a generic start for us. If you're looking at what it looks like to be in a worship community, in a church, and be loving to people, start with some patience and some kindness. Really positive things for all of us to think about as we navigate life in community together. And yet after that, what Paul's going to do next is he's going to give a number of negative attributes of love, things love isn't. I'm going to read them, and then I'm going to talk about each of them individually. This is what Paul says as he continues. Love, he's talking about, does not envy, it does not boast, it is not proud, it does not dishonor others, it is not self-seeking, it is not easily angered, it keeps no record of wrongs. Love does not delight in evil, but rejoices with the truth. A number of things listed that love does not do. It doesn't envy, boast, it isn't proud, dishonoring of others, self-seeking, easily angered, keeping a record of wrongs, or delight in evil. And yet when the Corinthian church is reading through this, they're hearing Paul's language talk about what life in community, this most excellent way you're supposed to do worship together, looks like. They wouldn't say, thanks for the exhaustive definition, Paul. They would say, oh no. In the first 12 chapters of this letter so far, he's called us out for every one of these things. It says that love doesn't envy. And yet, in chapter 3, verse 3, Paul told us we weren't ready for solid food yet, that we were still spiritual infants because we had jealousy and quarreling among us. It's our envy that's gotten us in trouble. And they've been confronted already for their envy. Love doesn't boast. Chapter 3, verse 21, chapter 4, verse 7, chapter 5, verse 6 are all places where Paul has yelled at the Corinthian church for their immoral and bad boasting of themselves and their own status. Love isn't proud. Best translated from its original language, love isn't puffed up. And yet, in chapter 4, verse 6, and verses 18 and 19, and chapter 5, verse 3, and chapter 8, verse 1, Paul has confronted them for the fact that they have felt puffed up by their knowledge. Paul said, knowledge puffs up, but love builds up. And this puffing up thing isn't a response of love. This is spiritual soloism on display. Love wouldn't dishonor others. And yet Paul, just before talking about the gifts, was talking about communion and how the community had dishonored each other by separating based on rich and poor as they celebrated meals together with who had and who was a have not, and that they weren't celebrating together in unity. They were dividing themselves and dishonoring each other. It's not self-seeking. When talking about meat sacrificed to idols, the people of Corinth were saying, we're allowed to do whatever we want, right? Just whatever's best for us and what's most free. And Paul says, no, you shouldn't just be seeking what's best for yourself. You should be willing to sacrifice for others and live in a way that wouldn't be a stumbling block to others. Not easily angered, no record of wrongs, not delighting in evil. Paul spent an entire chapter telling them that they need to stop being frustrated with each other, stop recording not just what each other has done wrong, but taking them to Roman court to try to get the convictions and punishments taking place in there, not to delight in what somebody else has done wrong so you can sue them for it. At every scope of what Paul says love isn't supposed to be, he's just walked through the beginning of his letter again and told the Corinthians everything he's just told them they are. They did not receive this as flowery language of a definition. They're supposed to receive this as conviction. Conviction of a group of people who have gathered together to worship, but haven't done so in the most excellent way. They've done so in a way that just prioritizes their own needs, their own desires, their own status, and their own life. And Paul's over it. So he says, it's like you don't even know the safety lessons of using the tools you've been given. So we need to learn it again. And then as he's finishing talking about love, he reminds them of some of what love does do. Verse 7, he continues, it, love, always protects, always trusts, always hopes, always perseveres. Paul's talking to a community about their life together. And so it's appropriate for us to ask this question. In your head, whether you're thinking about this particular local church or just the churches in America and in general, I'd ask you, does it operate that way? This church or the churches you've been a part of, does it feel like the people there protect each other? Trust each other? Always? Hope together? Persevere no matter what comes before them? Always persevere? Statistics across America would say that the last 2 years has shown this not to be true. But a pandemic would say that perseverance hasn't been the case. 30% of people who regularly attended a church 2 years ago aren't regularly attending a church anymore. It took 8 weeks, 8 weeks of a shutdown and not meeting together in person for 30% of people to no longer persevere in community of worship together. To take their hope and place it elsewhere. To decide maybe their community didn't respond the way they wanted to, and so perseverance, trust, protection feels different, so I'm going to go find somewhere else to worship. And yet Paul says the most excellent way would look like always protecting, always trusting, always hoping, always persevering. As Paul's talking about this, he's talking about what this looks like for a group of worshipers to gather together, like a local church. He's not talking about what love looks like in our individual lives, though the scriptures give lots of importance to that as well. The fruit of the Spirit in Galatians, when Paul writes in a different place, one of the fruits of the Spirit is love. It's something we should enact out individually, not just corporate when we gather together to worship, but individually as well. And while I'm not going to spend any time talking about that individually for us today, I do want to let you know, 6 weeks or so from now, you'll hear a message exactly on that. July 3rd, we'll be starting a series going through the fruit of the Spirit, the first of which is love. And one of our retired pastors, Pastor Don Knightem, will be preaching through what love looks like as a fruit of the Spirit, utilizing some of this own text from 1 Corinthians 13 to talk about the individual nature of that. And that comes as the start of what some of you may have heard about. If you ran our annual meeting, you heard about it. Otherwise, you may have heard just people talking about it, is that this summer we'll have a 9 or 10 week span where I'll be on a sabbatical. My wife and I will take vacations as a family. We'll do spiritual soul care retreats and some of that. And we will be gifted and blessed in the midst of that to have a number of our retired pastors, current staff members, church planters, and missionaries that will be speaking and preaching through that season while God is refreshing me in other ways. And I look forward to that. You'll hear more about it before it comes. The elders are prepared for it. The staff is prepared for it. You'll hear more about it as it gets coming. Okay, away from that tangent, both about individual love and me having a sabbatical, and back to the text. Paul's looking at the Corinthian church in the midst of giving them this safety lesson on the most excellent way to use the gifts, and then he comes back to an understanding about the gifts. This is what he says. Love never fails, but where there are prophecies, they will cease. Where there are tongues, they will be stilled. Where there is knowledge, it will pass away. For we know in part and we prophesy in part, but when completeness comes, what is in part disappears. Paul's saying these spiritual gifts, they're here for a season, they're here for a time, but they're going to end. They won't last forever. In eternity, we won't need the tongues of angels or the tongues of men. We'll all understand each other perfectly. In eternity, we won't need prophecy to speak on behalf of God. We'll be face to face with him and get to hear it directly. That when this completeness comes, when Jesus returns and things are fully complete, the spiritual gifts will cease. They won't be necessary any longer. But what will always be there, what will never fail, what will always remain, what will always have to be true of us, will be this most excellent way of love. We will live in that for eternity. That never ceases. It never fails. It is always part of us. Some of these things remain forever. Love is on that list. And some of these things will end. The gifts are on that list, Paul says. But that's normal. We understand this in a lot of ways of life. He gives an imagery towards that. Again, he says, when I was a child, I talked like a child. I thought like a child. I reasoned like a child. When I became a man, I put the ways of childhood behind me. For now we see only a reflection as in a mirror, and then we shall see face to face. Now I know in part, then I shall know fully, even as I am fully known. Two different images. First, the one of childhood into maturity. He says, some of the ways that we communicated as a child, they don't work the same way when we're adults. We even try to start training our kids not to do these things. There's a repeated phrase I do with a number of kids. If I'm coaching young kids, if I'm parenting young kids, if I'm around your kids and they're bothering me, I'm likely to say something like, whining doesn't work. It just doesn't work. Your whining doesn't make me empathetic towards your cause. It makes me frustrated and annoyed. It might be a way kids communicate, but as you mature, that needs to be a way of communication that ceases. It needs to stop. We all see that. We don't respond well when adults whine to us either. We assume that those things have changed. That's what Paul's saying, is these spiritual gifts are here and they're available and they're practical and they're useful and we should celebrate them. Paul wants them to be on display. And we'll talk a lot about that next week, about how he wants them to be on display, how we want them to be on display. But he says, but that won't be the end goal. Love is the end goal. That's the thing that will remain. The rest of it will cease. And then he says, because now we only see a reflection as in a mirror. This is imagery that would have jumped off the page for the Corinthian church because they happened to be in the first century one of the prime places mirrors were made. This is like using a car analogy in Detroit. Their community just understood it. And it happens to work when Paul's saying, because we have this grasp of what we think world, like the kingdom world is like for us, but we're really only seeing a small reflection of it. And even these gifts, they're kind of mysterious and not fully present and seen and understood the way that we would want them to be. There's always this incompleteness to them. He's not necessarily quoting it, but it's as if he's really familiar with the language God uses in Numbers when he's talking about Moses. Listen to what God says about prophets. When there's a prophet among you, I, the Lord, reveal myself to them in visions. I speak to them in dreams. This is not true of my servant Moses. He is faithful in all my house. When I speak with him, I speak face to face, clearly and not in riddles. He sees the form of the Lord. Paul is essentially saying we get to operate in these spiritual gifts as the Spirit gives them for our common good and for God's glory, but there's still this incomplete reflection. Someday we'll be face to face. We won't need that reflection anymore. It won't be a dream or a riddle or mysterious. It will all just be open and clear. We'll know fully just as we'll be fully known. And in the midst of that, he talks about the present, meaning the time between when the gifts have been given and when completeness comes and they cease. He talks about that. He says, as he's closing this thought, and now these three remain: faith, hope, and love. The greatest of these is love. Until the completeness comes and we're fully face to face before God, what we have, the most significant tools we have, are faith, hope, and love. And the greatest of them is love. Faith is a trust that we direct towards God, who's kept his faith and covenant promises with us by sending Jesus for our sake and raising him to new life. Hope is our focused and fervent desire to see a broken world restored by God to its rightful wholeness. And love loves the foretaste of our ultimate union with God. It's graciously given to us now and shared with our brothers and sisters. That's what Paul says. That as we're in community and worship together, while the gifts may be on display, while miracles may happen, while all sorts of right, true things may be tasks we're supposed to accomplish, the most important thing we can do as a community of believers together is root ourselves in that love. that without it, it's all useless. We could move the mountains and it wouldn't matter. We could give everything to the poor and it wouldn't matter. But the love, the one thing that will remain, that is what matters. Well, generally, for the last year and a half, I've always ended a message with three ways you can put this into practice throughout the week. I'm going to change up from that a little bit today to give us one thing I hope you do throughout the week, but that I'm going to ask you to do even right now while we're gathered together. An immediate application to pray that our church will be marked by faith, hope, and love. Not by pride, ambition, conflict, envy, dishonoring of others, easily angered, delighting in evil, any of those other things. To spend time in community together saying, we most want to be rooted in this excellent way you've given us. And instead of me just praying it and you all agreeing with me, I'm going to take a few moments of silence and kind of just guide you through praying it yourselves. So you'll just pray individually to God. And I know that's hard for some people, or it can feel awkward for some people as we just communicate with God. And so I'll give you some of the kind of prompts for the things that I want you to be praying about. So we're going to spend just a few minutes together in silence as I guide us through what you can be thinking and joining your spirit with and communicating to God internally. And then in a few moments, I'll close us. Would you pray that our church would be marked by faith? And no matter what's around us, that we would see God's goodness in it and his faithfulness to us. Pray that we would be a place that protect each other spiritually. That we'd be a place that trusts each other. We would hope together for God to do good things. That in unity we'd persevere through sin or circumstance towards love. Pray against the temptation to be about our own agenda or pride. Pray against any conflict in our church. Pray that we wouldn't do the right things, but with the wrong motives. Pray that we wouldn't be hypocritical and only do the right things we want to do. Pray that the most significant thing that would define us is our love for each other. God, your word is clear and we trust it. And it says that love would never fail. That love that comes from you, that your Spirit gifts to us, that overflows in and through us, that's modeled for us by Christ, that it would never fail. In fact, it says that your love through us would go on to show others who you are, that would point people towards your goodness and towards relationship with you. And so we give everything we do to you, praying that it wouldn't just be a list of your power, that it wouldn't just be a list of tasks we hope to see happen, that it wouldn't just be our faith on display, but that it would all be rooted in the love you say is best. And that the result of that would be more people coming into your kingdom, more glory to your name, more unity in our church, and more of an expression of your kingdom the way you've designed it to be. We know that only happens because of the love that's been expressed through Christ and continues to be expressed to us still today. And so we ask it all in Jesus' name. Amen. My hope as we go today is that we would go in love. Love for the people in this church, love for the others and brothers and sisters in Christ around the world. If there's people here that you don't know, I'd encourage you to connect with someone before you leave. Tangibly get to know them in some small way. Start to express relationship and love towards them. And then as you go out throughout the week, if you're willing and do you remember, would you please pray for our church throughout the week? We'll talk about the individual aspects of love in a few weeks, but pray for how love would define us as a church community throughout this week as you go. As you go this morning, go with grace and peace. Thanks for worshiping with us.
Prosper when the darkness falls, it won't prevail. 'Cause the God I serve.